Thank you for joining us today. My name's Darlene McLennan and I'm the manager of the Australian Disability Clearinghouse on Education and Training, ADCET for short. The webinar today is live captioned and also Auslan interpreted. To activate the captions, you can click on the CC button in the toolbar that is located either on the top or on the bottom of your screen. We also have captions available via a browser. And we'll put that link into the chat now for people to access. I'm coming to you from Lutchwida, Tasmanian Aboriginal land, and in the spirit of reconciliation, I want to respectfully acknowledge the Lutchwida nations and also recognise the Aboriginal history and culture of the land and pay my respects to elders past and present and to the many Aboriginal people that did not make elder status. I also want to acknowledge all the countries participating in this meeting and also acknowledge their elders and ancestors and the legacy to us and any Aboriginal and also any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people participating in the webinar today. I'm really delighted to welcome you to this session, What's Next for Digital Accessibility? This is in recognition of Global Accessibility Awareness Day, GAD, which is today. We will be tweeting this, so the hashtag is hashtag capital G, capital A, capital A, capital D. So join us on Twitter, but also there'll be conversations happening in the chat box. So they're very excited to be partnering with RMIT for this session, but I'm not going to facilitate it, so I love it. I've just done the welcome and then I can sit back and relax and enjoy the panel discussion. So I'm going to hand over to Chaminda Ranasinghe, who is the Chief Executive Officer for Global Marketing, Digital and Experience at RMIT University. Chaminda didn't want me to say anything else, but I'm going to say that he has 25 years expertise in marketing, digital and technology. And he's currently the executive sponsor of accessibility at RMIT. Which is fantastic. And we were just commenting that it would be wonderful that if all universities had such a thing. So maybe that's our wish from today. All right, I'll hand over to you, Chaminda, and I'll be back at the end of the session to say goodbye and wrap it all up. Take care.
Thank you, Darlene, and hello, everybody. It's great to be partnering with ADCET on such a great day that where we acknowledge accessibility and remember and recognise all the great work that we have done. And as Darlene mentioned, I am the Chief Experience Officer at RMIT, but what I'm very, very proud of is I'm the Executive Champion for Accessibility and Inclusion at the University. I'm very proud of the team that have led the work that has brought the University to be recognised as one of the leading disability champions. We've actually been recognised as high as number one in the country by the Australian Network for Disability, but recently we've been ranked second. So there's a lot of work that goes into this. We've in fact recently been accredited being a disability confident recruiter. So lots of things that we have done well, but the reality is at RMIT, we know it's a continuous journey, not about a destination. We haven't stopped just because we got those awards. I'm sure all the participants here recognize the fact that there is a long way to go for us. And that's what this discussion is about. The last year has been, you know, the COVID and the pandemic circumstances have been really tough, but there have been some positives that have come out of it. And one of those key positives have certainly been the sort of the drive and the engagement, the enablement of digital and the move of online learning and teaching into this space. And it's been fantastic to see so many of our students and staff take up digital tools that in the past sometimes haven't been taken up as much. It's also helped us identify the needs of all of our students and staff when it comes to digital and that context of the importance of accessibility. And that's the important discussion that we need to have. How do we make sure that we don't lose the traction that we've gained in the last few years and continue to drive the agenda and do more? At RMIT, we are really lucky to have some amazing accessibility specialists. In fact, Ronnie, who's on the screen, is a colleague and teammate of mine, has advanced in the short time he's been at the university, the agenda even further. And as I said, this is not done for us. There's a lot long way to go, but being recognized as a leader in this space, our job is to bring others into the discussion. And that's why it's great today that we have got participants and speakers from other institutions, because together we can advance the discussion further. We can achieve more together. And I think that's the part that we've got to play. The progress to make this work for everybody, we've got to progress the conversation to a national level and make it more inclusive to all the institutions, because reality is, I think, this is something that we can do together for the entire sector. And as a sector, we can then encourage other sectors to do more in this space as well. So that's the context for this. I'm delighted to be the sort of moderator, but the important conversation will happen through our participants, who are the true specialists in this space. So in that context, I would love our panel to introduce themselves. Let's start with who you are, what your role is, and what does digital inclusion mean for you in a short, sharp, maybe 2 or 3 minute session. So can I please start with Darren?
Yes, thank you, Chiminda. I'd like to first off say thanks and hi to everybody from here, and let you know I'm coming from Wurundjeri land here in Preston in Melbourne in Victoria, and pay my acknowledgements to elders past and present as well. So I'm Darren Britton, and I am the National Assistive Technology Project Officer with the Australian Disability Clearinghouse on Education and Training. My role consists of anything and everything, I suppose, around assistive technologies. I've been in this space for a couple of decades now. And around the intersection with information access. So anything from training and support across the tertiary sector, with my position now, through to targeted programs and initiatives aimed at raising awareness and knowledge around assistive technologies, inclusive practices. The question, what does digital inclusion mean to me? I think it's a really good question, because I think it's a question that we all need to be asking in this time, that the discussion around accessibility post-COVID, as you mentioned, is where people's heads are at and thinking, what is next? And when I think of digital inclusion, I think of digital interactions, and there's three words that come to mind for me, and that is access, opportunity, and representation. Access allows people into the space, opportunity enables people to grow and thrive in the space, and representation allows people to see themselves and others. So I think, I'll leave it at that, because I know there's a lot of panelists to get through, but they're the three big things for me that represents. So it's no easy challenge for us all to address all of those things all at once. And it is a journey, as you said, Jaminda. So thank you.
Thanks, Darren. Great to have you on board. Tracy, I'll go to you next.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Tracy Galloway. I am currently an equitable advisor at RMIT University. My role involves working directly with individual students with a wide range of disabilities and conditions across both vocational and higher education, to support them with their studies through reasonable adjustments, which includes digital accessibility. I also work closely with educators in various schools and faculties to support them in implementing these reasonable adjustments through learning, teaching, and assessment. I have a background in education, so I started teaching in schools. Have also had management positions in schools in charge of curriculum areas like music and performing arts, and then moved to higher education as lecturer and coordinator of multiple subjects within a new graduate teaching degree. All of those roles have really given me an experience of being able to build curriculum and build subject content, keeping in mind accessibility on digital platforms like Moodle, Blackboard, and Canvas. I've also done some counselling in schools as well as a registered counsellor, and have built wellbeing programmes, again, in the digital space for access students. Digital inclusion for me is about having that equal access and be immersed in the learning experience without barriers. From a personal perspective, I was born with low vision, has progressively deteriorated. Essential as food or water for me in my life, because it does enable me to really engage in every aspect of my life. And I'm very hopeful and excited about future innovations and progress to be made. I'll hand you over to my colleague, Ronnie.
Thank you. Thank you, Tracy. Thank you, Chiminda. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ronnie Andrade. I work as digital accessibility lead at RMIT University on Chaminda's team in the operations portfolio. And my role spans across the entire product lifecycle. So I try to champion and embed accessibility best practices during the design, development, and use of digital assets by our squads at RMIT. I've been working on the digital accessibility space since a very early age, since I was 18. First, I was an instructor of assistive technology at the university where I did my bachelor's. Then a couple of years later, I did a PhD where I researched accessibility in video games for people who are blind. And then I came to RMIT to continue working on this space of digital accessibility. What digital access means to me, in my eyes, it's about two things. First, it's about making sure that everyone can access any content without having to spend extra time or extra cognitive efforts trying to set up programs, wondering if something is going to work for them, and just be able to use tools without having to spend that extra time. And the second thing about that is, to me, digital access, it's about equitable experiences. It's about providing those alternatives. If for whatever reason, a digital experience is not available to someone, there must be an alternative equitable experience. I'll leave it at that and pass it on to the next panelist.
Thank you, Ronnie. It's great to hear from both you and Tracy. We'll go to Danny from Deakin. Welcome.
Yeah, hello, Chaminda. Welcome. A welcome that I'm feeling very deeply from my colleagues at RMIT. Thank you so much for inviting me along. I'm lecturer of inclusive education at Deakin University. I work in the teaching capabilities team. My roots go deep at the university. I pretty much stretch across every aspect because inclusion impacts students in just so many different areas and ways across the university. I'll keep it short and sharp and say that for me, inclusivity is about equity and social justice and the transformative power of education. And everybody has the right to have their life transformed and realized through education. This is big stuff we're doing, heady things we're talking about. So I'll pass on to the next person.
So well said, Danny, thank you. We'll go to Stephen from La Trobe now.
Hi, my name's Stephen Zelko. I am the coordinator of inclusive resource development, tech and training, quite the mouthful, at La Trobe Uni. My role extends throughout the institution. It goes from dealing with students on a day-to-day basis, face-to-face sort of stuff, training them through software, handling their alternative format requirements. So going through the LMS and digging out stuff and trying to work with that sort of stuff as well. It works through to advising academics on how to create better resources. And then it goes up to sort of like helping with drafting policy in regards to sort of institutional change. So it covers a pretty wide gamut. I've been at the institution since 1999 when I was a student, and then I started in the inclusive resource department about 2005. So I've been in the space for quite a while, seeing the sort of the transformation that went on with COVID and shifting to a more hybrid sort of platform. And at this point, what does digital inclusion actually mean for me? I think it's, and a few people here have probably heard me say it before, but it's no longer for me, it's no longer about even about accessibility or inclusion. It's about communication. So it's about better practices in communicating the things that we're trying to get through to students. So when better communication comes in, students aren't excluded at all on any sort of level, regardless where they are on the sort of the spectrum. So yeah, it's all, to me now, it's primarily defined by better communication. Can we do it better? Yeah.
Thank you, Stephen. Great points you raise. And finally, and again from La Trobe, welcome Boyana.
Thank you very much. Hi, everyone. My name is Boyana Sharkic. I'm a lecturer in audiology at La Trobe University. I have three different roles in my job, two of which I'm not paid for. So one of them is to train students to become clinical audiologists and to be able to provide services in terms of diagnosing and rehabilitating hearing loss. And the other one is to train them to understand the theoretical content of that, as well as to talk to other academics within the university about how we can provide inclusive education through accessible content. Digital inclusion, what it means to me, again, thinking about these couple of roles that I have, I believe it's important to realize that the access to information should be available to everyone, regardless of their age, background, or ability. And particularly thinking from the health educational sector, where we need to provide accessible services in terms of teleaudiology or telehealth to vulnerable populations, improving this digital literacy in our students, not only to be able to access content themselves, but also to pass that information on to their future employment is critical for their future practice in audiology. Thank you.
Thank you, Boyana. I think we are incredibly lucky, audience, to have this wonderful panel with us today. And the points that all of you have raised, I mean, communication is literally the most universal skill that every job requires. And as educators, as staff from universities, it's our absolute core responsibility to make sure that that's what we provide our students and staff. So I think this conversation is going to be fantastic. The first question I'd like to ask all of the audience and also the panel is, what's your reflection on how digital accessibility has been transformed throughout the past few years? And there's a second part to this question, I'm being cheeky. How has that expectation on academics and teaching staff changed in the context of the last few years particularly? Who'd like to go first?
I'm happy to jump in and take one for the team here with that. Thanks, Shaminda. Reflections. I mean, I just casting my mind back, I can remember some of my first work in this space was involved a book press and a high quality camera at that stage on a tripod. So a large piece of glass would come down on the book and hold a page down flat so that a photo could be taken. So that then we could take that, process that through the image lab that was there, get that single page of the book back, and then scan and try and optically recognize the text that was on that page to convert this into an electronic format for a student. So you can imagine doing a book took, you know, close to a day, because you have to wind the glass up, open it up again, put it back down for the next page, etc. And that was fairly fast for its time. That was considered, you know, the way things were done. I remember our groundbreaking moment, we saw there was an article from a US university that was talking about they had a high-speed scanner that was doing OCRing that and they would we go, how do they get through a book so quickly with this stuff? We go, this technology is amazing, you know, technology had advanced, and it involved chopping the spine off the book. And they were talking about, we said, oh, we've never even thought of doing that. So again, we took ideas from elsewhere and we started to implement those, and then we could scan the book in 20 minutes, and then you still would go through and correct errors, etc. But the time saving, again, we used to think it was great if we could get something done in the space of a week, one whole book, if we couldn't get that book done within the morning or an afternoon, by the end of my time when I was at La Trobe, that was something we're looking at. But yeah, things through from, we used to have students reading articles to tape. We now use, you know, synthetic speech. So there's been transformations in that space. Audio online has now come along. The disability standards have come along, which have certainly helped transform things. The web standards, and I often cast my mind back to, you know, the early days. We're talking about reflections or, you know, expectations on academic staff, where we had reading packs, you know, and there was like 15, 20 resources, maybe key articles or key chapters, etc., that were required as part of a syllabus or of the curriculum. And they had to be in, you know, a month, 2 months before a teaching period began, because that was when they had to go to the printery to get done and put into the bookshop for students to then purchase, etc. And that was, you had everything all in one place. Now we're talking about, there's so much information. There's more than 15 you know, resources involved in a subject. There's, in the case of some subjects that I've seen, you know, there's hundreds of links going out. There's hundreds of different resources that students are expected to interact with. So academics have to need to keep on top of all that, keep that current. The expectation is that they've got high digital literacy skills. And that's just innate, and it's not without training. We're just expecting people to be able to adapt to this new technologies. They need to be masters of everything, and they've got to do more with less time and resources. I'm not saying these are all positive things. This is how I kind of see the environment. And I think we're very much stuck in the sector. I've seen it from many institutions now that we're in this just-in-time teaching model. You know, most resources are getting developed just in time, just the week before or 2 weeks before. They're not getting developed 3 months ahead of time, 6 months ahead of time before a course is announced and run. But that's the nature of, I think, most things that we're now doing. But I'm happy for somebody else to continue that discussion.
Thanks, Dan. Lots of nods there from the panel. I can see that's the case. Anyone else would like to comment?
I'm happy to add something to that. I haven't been on the space for as long as Darren, but my experience on web basically is that, recently I attended a talk with Sir Tim Berners-Lee, the creator of the standard for the World Wide Web. And he was saying that the idea of the World Wide Web originally was to share, to make content available to everyone. That was the spirit of the foundation of the World Wide Web. And at first, when it was first launched around the mid-90s, we had very basic web pages, no animations, a bit bland, if you will, with just like links and a picture here and there, and it was very simple. And those pages were quite easy to decode for assistive technology users. But then in the mid-2000s, we started building what we call the Web 2.0, which is where technology advanced so that anyone could create their own content. And we created more interactive elements on web pages. We started seeing carousels and accordions and tabs and lots of interactive and new elements on the web. And unfortunately, when that transition happened from Web 1.0 to 2.0, a big part of that accessibility that was embedded in Web 1.0 was lost because we focused on the interactions and in making it look pretty and in making it enticing visually, but we forgot the basics. So I guess my reflection here is let's not forget the basics as we move along into the future of digital accessibility.
Great point, Ronnie, and the funny thing you talk about, and Darren. The early days, I mean, I remember back in the, let's be fair, very early days of the internet in the early 90s, mid 90s, not coming from the background that you've come from, I'm not from education, but even in the corporate sector, it was often a fight, sort of say, you'd have to fight for the sort of W3 standards, accessibility. The good thing, I don't see that being the issue, is people are very much conscious of that. Sometimes we do forget the basics. So I think going back to the very simple things are sorted out and thought through, and I think are very, very important. I'm conscious that from an academic perspective, I think you spoke about that, Darren. I'm going to try and ask maybe Danny to lead off from an academic perspective of how you think the last few years.
Yeah, I'm definitely, I'm keen to speak to an academic perspective because I'm really reminded of 15 years ago working at our Institute of Queer Education, and we were doing a community-based delivery model. So our Indigenous students were encouraged to have 2 weeks on campus in intensive blocks, but they would be embedded in country and with their communities. And it was a very inspirational model for delivering education, and it still is. But one of the great challenges of delivering education in that mode was that we had to be very, very inventive because our students didn't have access to, you know, great bandwidth or downloads or... So I remember recording on a dictaphone and trying to get that recording onto a disc and then getting a little pack and putting it in the mail and saying, like, here's a week of your studies for those students, and hoping that it would they would receive it. And you just think how far we've come, but also how little far we've come. Because I think that our rural and remote students, we've forgotten that, you know, accessibility is so much more than the way we present pages. It's also the way that a person receives that information and if they can receive that information. So, you know, like how much things change and how much things stay the same. And I think we really just have to remember that human bodies are connected to technologies, and for things to reach people, they have to reach people. Stephen, I see your hands up.
I was going to carry on from that. I think for me, the reflection that's really evident at the moment is the shift from the use of technology as a tool, and you would, you know, a hammer or a nail or anything like that, to the shift of it's being, you're engaging with it on its own merits. So you're having to bring yourself to the tech rather than the tech coming to you. And that to me is the biggest transformation in the last, say, 10 years or the last 15 years, is that we're using things to substitute a shortcoming, where now that's what I say to a lot of sort of mostly academics that I go speak to, is like, okay, we have to shift the focus here and the perception. You have to engage with the platform on its own standing. You have to come to the platform and come to the community and say, okay, well, like, well, how am I engaging with you, rather than thinking, oh, how do I fix the problem using this hammer? Because it's just going to get done, and it's just not a way to go about it. It's a very sort of one-sided approach. You've got to kind of be symbiotic with it. The other reflection is the retroactive nature of the process previously, and the proactive nature of it now. We have to come at things from inception rather than, okay, how do we fix it once it's already in the system? How do we get it done once it's already there? How do we get it before it's even started? How do you change the type of engagement that you get from inception? So they're the two major ones for me. But yeah, the tool rather than the tool and the communal aspect of it is a huge one for me from that space.
Stephen, I so agree with you. It can't be an afterthought. That's the challenge we have. It's often, you know, the old days of go back to, let's create a PDF and then just make, a Word document and put into PDF, and then let's call it digital. Same sort of concept. You can't be, it's going to be designed from scratch. I completely agree with you. Maybe I'll go to Tracy or Boyana. Have any thoughts on this topic?
So from my perspective, just listening to the other panelists and their reflections, very, very interestingly, about 10 years ago, I used to do a lot of work in Aboriginal communities in the Northeast Arnhem Land. And we used to fly out there as clinical audiologists and provide hearing services to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. We didn't have enough funding to do that very frequently, despite the fact that the people over there suffer from chronic middle ear infections and they needed the care on a frequent basis. We were only able to get there maybe once every 3 months due to flooding, and we would fly in there using single engine planes. 10 years later, and particularly with the push from COVID, we were able to create simulation clinics and actually access the clinical centres in these communities and provide audiological services in an online type of a way, which allows us now to see these people on a much more frequent basis. So drawing on from that, in audiology, at the Masters of Clinical Audiology at La Trobe, we have to provide students with a certain number of clinical hours every year in order to meet accreditation standards and requirements for them to be able to practice as audiologists. With all the hospitals being closed, we weren't able to send them out on placements. So we were risking losing accreditation from audiologists, really, from the professional body. So we were able to create simulation clinics at La Trobe, where we use technology to simulate patients for students to conduct assessments, to manage patients with those assessments, and also to tune into hospitals through that digital technology and see patients in a Zoom or Teams type of fashion. So that's an incredible move forward, I think, compared to where we were, you know, just 18 months ago.
Yeah, great call out there, Boyana. I mean, it's interesting you speak, both, I think you and some of the other panelists have spoken about rural students from the outback and remote areas. And this has also really sort of taught us about international students who couldn't come to Australia to study. So this has really changed the game on how we service their needs as well. So it's a really important point. Tracy, I might give the last word to you. on this topic.
Sure, thank you. I agree with everything that's been said to date. I mean, when I started teaching, I call it the era of BG before Google, where you had to physically do everything. And we've come light years ahead just in a very short time. And I do wonder whether, in terms of how people view accessibility, and companies like Apple, I feel, have really innovated and embraced accessibility because they've built it into the operating systems from the ground up, whereas others have kind of looked at it as an add-on, as Steve was saying. And I think that we need to change how we view accessibility and how we perceive it. I think we are way behind in educating people about accessibility just because of the rate in which it's moved. I work with students all of the time who are completely unaware that they have a whole range of accessibility tools within their operating systems and what they're used for. And I think also there's still a bit of a misconception out there that these disabilities, when in actual fact it can benefit everyone universally in how they interact and how they engage with content, and especially digital content.
That's such a wonderful point you make, Tracy, and it's actually really timely. We had a session yesterday where we had Apple and Microsoft and some of the other technology partners showcasing what they've done in the recent past. I was blown away with just the technology that comes literally out of the box. And you know, almost, I was a little bit ashamed that being the accessibility, the champion for accessibility, that I hadn't taken the time to learn it. So your point is really valid. And the tools that are available now makes it so wonderful for everybody. And I think it's part of all of our roles to make that awareness and education come to life. So that's a really good point. A great call to end that topic on. So let's go to the next question. In harnessing the COVID circumstance, I mean, the disruption was quite broad, which I accept. But at the same time, there were some real positives that came out of it. It's forced us in some ways to put our subjects, our courses, our programs online. Many that some of us thought couldn't have, you know, we thought that we probably couldn't have done that before the COVID circumstance, but it forced us. So with, you know, some things that we thought never possible are now absolutely the way that we do things. So in that context, I'm interested to find out how institutions manage the hybrid way of learning and how we'd not lose what we've gained, particularly through the lens of accessibility. And maybe this is directed to the academic panel, members of the panel. So can I start with Boyana, maybe yourself?
Sure, thank you, Chimunda. So thank you very much for this question. I think you are 100% right. COVID has certainly pushed the academic world into a space where they were very reluctant of ever visiting. So we were found at one point of not really having a choice. Like most academics around Australia, I think people went and started teaching via Zoom, and it was almost like taking what existed and just kind of streaming that information through Zoom without much further thought. What we did in audiology with the help of some staff from the accessibility unit, including Stephen Zelko, is we trialled a couple of different options using Teams, where we were able to provide students with closed captioning, immediate access to video recordings of lectures, interaction between peers, interaction between students and staff as well. And everything kind of centralized in this one space that students could access through their phones, through computers, without searching endlessly through, for example, forum posts on LMS. The feedback that we received from students, and not just students with hearing difficulties, but students overall, was extremely positive. They tend to refer to it as like a social platform like Facebook or Instagram, where they can communicate with one another very quickly. And they really, really loved it, to the point where a lot of them were wondering whether we can leave LMS in the past and move all of our teaching onto Microsoft Teams. So that was something that was really, really positive. And so now in the entire course of audiology, both for the Master of Clinical Audiology and the Bachelor of Applied Science and Master of Clinical Audiology, we teach all of our subjects through Microsoft Teams, and it's there to stay. In response to your question, what do we do and how do we avoid sort of a regression back to where we were? I think it's important to consider this question from, I guess, the motivation for change and, you know, what motivates people to change and how we can facilitate that. And we know that there are people who tend to take risks and who are willing to do this, the digital innovators, and then some who need information about factual information as to why this is really important. And then some of those people who are kind of, you know, negotiation stage for hours and end. And then we have a group of people who would rather not ever go near that. So I think it's really, really important to consider the type of personalities you're working with, to enter into a stage of talking, sharing, and joining forces with people who you know are on your side, and showcasing, like what we're doing today. So doing shared practice seminars, spreading the word within not only your discipline, but your department, the university, streamlining all of this information on an organizational level so that people like me don't have to start from scratch, so that people like me know where to go to and have a wealth of this information presented to them. And another thing I think it's really, really important is that we recognize that we all play a role in this, but that the organization as a whole on that top level has an extremely important role, and that role is to set those expectations. If expectations are not set, people are not motivated to move forward to that. Thank you.
Totally agree, Brian. I think it's a really great call, and we can't forget the power of community. So I think that call to action around sharing is a great point you make. Danny, I might come to you next.
Yeah, it's really funny. I've been reflecting as you were speaking, Bojana, and I was thinking about why I fell out of academia, and I was a broken academic for a while, and it was the LMS that broke me. And it broke me because I was trying to maintain two teaching practices, one that was traditional and I was really attached to and loved because I'm a bit of a show pony and a performer, and I loved that interaction with the students. And then I was also trying to maintain a digital teaching practice at the same time, which is impossible. And I just couldn't find a way to bring those two things together. So I came back into academia as a learning designer because I felt like there was an opportunity there that I'd missed something. I couldn't do it while I was in the heat of teaching. I needed to kind of get out. And I think what I would say, there is something of the ethics of care for our academic teams that they are sort of trapped between two worlds at the moment still, and the forced shift online has only exacerbated that. And I suppose from my perspective in teaching capability building, it's about having those very soft and loving and gentle conversations with people that enable them. And I think that my boss, my lead, my due north Barbie Panther at Deakin University, that's what we're all about in the teaching capabilities team, is really, really understanding, like, how do we enable people? How do we walk with them in this path, wherever they are in their teaching practice, and understanding that people are truly invested in the embodiment of teaching practice. So how do we bring them into the world of the digital and enable that kind of teaching practice to still occur in that space? I think learning design has a really strong story to tell in that space. But I also think there's a number of other, again, embodied conversations that we have at our university with our people. And you know, this is a journey of 1,000 conversations, I believe. Tracy, I'll hand over to you.
Tracy, I think we might...
Sorry, I had a little technical issue there. Thanks. Hopefully you can all hear me now.
We can now, Tracy.
Thank you for points there. Can you hear me now?
We can, Tracy. Please go ahead.
Oh, fantastic. Sorry about that. Really great points there about just the impact on everyone in the learning space through COVID. Certainly, it's my experience being in education for many years that change is always very slow. And obviously pre-COVID, a lot of universities were starting to think about that kind of hybrid learning, blended learning, but still very much in the infancy. And all of that infrastructure and support hadn't really been built yet. And then COVID kind of just accelerated everyone into that. I know that I'm biased, but I do believe that every educator in this country deserves a massive pay rise for the work that they have done over the last 2 years, because it is a huge effort to change the way that you deliver learning from face to face and you know, into that sort of digital realm. But also just in terms of students, I think as we're working with students through equitable learning, we did come across students who did have some difficulty with access to, you know, a regular internet service, students who didn't have devices that were particularly, you know, particularly competent, and so really struggled through that sort of environment, just having to do everything digitally. And just that, you know, our student cohort now is very diverse. We have a whole range of age groups, and some mature students haven't grown up with technology, and I think universities need to keep that in mind, that not everyone is at the same technical proficiency with technology, and we can't just assume that they are. So we need to build some structure and some support in there for them too. So when we're looking at hybrid learning and how it continues, I think we really have to look at access, affordability, and technical ability, as well as just how academics can be supported to then continue to build these platforms and the content and be able to do it face-to-face and online, which is kind of almost double the work that's been asked of them.
Thank you, Tracy. It's some really valid points. And to be fair, this is why it's wonderful to have such a diverse panel from so many different institutions, so you get this shared learning. So that's probably where I'm going to lead this next question with. And I'm going to try and bring some of the other panelists onto the discussion. You know, how do we as organizations from, you know, we're in the same sector, but you know, at the end of the day, we don't always partner as much as we could do. And how do we work better together to reduce the duplication of effort, which you've spoken about, and improve what we've all gained in the space of inclusion and accessibility in the digital education space. So let me start, maybe Ronnie, I'll come back to some of the others, but Ronnie, can I start with you on this one?
Yes, sure. That's a tough one for me. So how do we collaborate and work together in this space? Look, each institution has developed their own way of working, right? I think forums like this one, where we got the opportunity to share and to learn from one another, are going to be key into the future. So I'm all for sharing the love, as my manager says, in terms of what we have learned. If you create a resource, make sure that it's available for others. If you have a discussion like this one, publicize it, bring people from other parts, from other universities, from other states, because there's richness in diversity. And we all know that, because that's our space, that's where we work. So do bring different points of view, different opinions together. That's the best way to learn and to ensure that we don't reinvent the wheel, basically. And I guess another important thing is about standards. So have you developed a best practice? How did it go? Can you share that best practice with others? Can others build on the best practice that you developed and adapt it to their own institutions? To me, it's all about sharing, I would say. And I'll leave it at that for now.
Thank you, Ronnie. I saw Steve nod quite a lot there. Steve, what about your thoughts on this?
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. But stuff like the ADCET community of practice has been almost contingent to upskilling my own practice over the last probably year and a half, because it's created sort of a lateral way of sharing the information when we're perpetually looking for literal ways to implement it. So it's usually vertical. Oh, you do this and it leads to this kind of thing. But the being able to sit with a, you know, once a month or once every 5 weeks with 30 other practitioners from here and from across the nation and New Zealand and stuff has meant that you're checking your best practice all the time, and you can have other people double check your working out for you. So you can kind of go, okay, has someone used this piece of software, and someone's already probably went through it. And there was one very sort of like heated sort of discussion about one very specific piece of software that someone had already walked through all of it, and it saved everyone else time in order to sort of go through it themselves. So stuff like that, where you're doing maintenance on your own knowledge, is a requirement. It's absolute necessity for me at the moment. I won't try anything new until I've checked with all these other people to say, okay, like, what have you guys been doing with it? And having that face-to-face in those discussions. So it's not just throwing it up on a forum and saying, okay, has anyone used this? But actually having a sit down and what have you been doing and what have you been using and how you've implemented this, or what has someone else been doing? These are now absolutely contingent to the process, that you can't not do it the other way. Yeah, so that was a huge one for me, I think.
Thanks, Stephen. Danny, what are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, it's an interesting tangle, right? Because I think anybody who sits in the accessibility space, you suddenly find yourself in these very tentacular relationships across the whole university. You know, you think that, okay, well, I have a problem before me where I really need to work in teaching capability space to build accessibility know-how and love in with academic teaching staff. But then you think, well, I can't really start there because I've got to think about procurement, and I've got to think, like, how do I reach right back into the process so I can take the burden of that conversation you know. And then you think, okay, well, if I can do that, what about template design? What about in our learning management system? And what if we have a one deacon approach, which we have a wonderful team working on a one deacon approach to a template that has inbuilt accessibility and inclusivity at its core. Okay, well, that's a great conversation. Now we're starting to be able to really sort of apportion little pieces to different parts of the university, but it's there's an individual responsibility. Like, we've all got a piece of the pie that we got to eat. It's also teams, but it's more than that. It's the institution, but it's more than that. It's institutions working with other institutions in the sector, but it's more than that, because it's like you were saying, Chaminda, it's about partnerships with you know, big business as well. Like, we, you know, suddenly we breach our borders and suddenly the conversation gets very big. And I find myself within this conversation saying, but I'm one little woman. How do I do this? And it's like one bite at a time, you know. And I think you're laughing because you know what I mean. And I think that we've all got to kind of ask ourselves, what's the extent of my influence, but also what are the limits of it as well? And how do I work with other people to really our sector and our responsibility? I'm going to go back to the ethical and the moral and the social justice responsibility on all of our shoulders in higher education today. This is our challenge. Accessibility is our challenge.
So well said, Danny. And look, go back to that purpose of why we do what we do. I think it's a huge call that you make. And it's almost it's the basic responsibility we have as educators and people that work in universities. We set a level of expectation when students come through. The way they experience their early career, early journey, is what they take forward to other organizations. So you talk about the shadow we cast. If we set a strong set of expectations, they will then demand it wherever they go. So this is a really wonderful point you make. Darren, last word on this point.
Oh, last word. There's probably many words to have on this point, to keep this short. And I think... Yeah, this comes down to value. How much do we value accessibility as institutions, and what value do we actually add to, you know, passing that on, as you said, to that next generation of learners that are coming through? So, you know, it's in our assessment tasks as well. It's in, are we teaching students to be accessible in their own work? Are we teaching them, if they're doing presentations, to make sure that there's captions and alternate things? You know, do we value this? Do we add it into the marking rubrics, etc.? But I think there's a bigger discussion around that, reducing the, as you're saying, you know, that duplication and value things. And Danny hit it there, and I know it's the topic of discussion across the sector at the moment, and that is the procurement issue of things. Imagine if all the universities got together, or through University of Australia, and turned to Blackboard, or turned to Turnitin, who still hasn't fixed their accessibility, by the way, and said, we're not using your tool anymore. You can't sell it to every other institution, or that we're, none of us are using it because it's not accessible. And so either go and start updating that and give us tools that have accessibility, and when we install them with the accessibility features turned on. More often than not, they come in, ICT isn't looped in on that accessibility discussion in some cases, the change management process isn't. And so most of the accessibility features, even if they are present, are turned off by default. Humans are really good at taking something good and just, as you said, patch a bit of stuff on it, make it look good and do everything else and break everything at the same time. If anybody has a chance, I would tell everybody to look up the Wayback Machine if you haven't used it online, and go back to your own institution's website from 2000, 2004, 2002, 2000. If it's there on the Wayback Machine, it holds copies of your institution's website. You can look back at some of them and go, our website was so much simpler back then. Information was just all that was needed. It was, here's the key bits of information you need, and that's all we're giving you, not all the fluff and everything else that's on there. So I'll kind of leave it at that because I know there's more discussion to come.
Great call, Darren. Let's not, you know, the benchmark we set accepts is the acceptance that we then pass on to our students and other staff. So let's demand it. I think that's a great call. Fantastic responses. Let's go to the next question. So if the teaching staff are a piece of the puzzle when it comes to students with disability experience, the question is, you know, how do organizations need to support our teaching staff to ensure accessibility is provided without overloading you? I think we've already touched on this a little bit. I think it is that some of the comments we've had, I think it did touch a note, if you like. So I think it's an important discussion. Tracy, can I start with you, please?
Thank you. Just following on the previous conversations, teachers are very much a part of this, but as far as accessibility is concerned, everyone is responsible. It should take the whole village to make it happen. It should be intrinsic in everything that we do, rather than having to, things work learning and working directly with students that we hear, is just a lack of consistency at the moment across their learning experience. And so some students will go to a class and have a really great experience where there's accessibility readily built in and available to them. And then they'll go to consistency, is really important university-wide. And what would really help there is having some sort of infrastructure and a framework, an institution-wide framework, where everything is there, information, resources, guidelines, standards, everything is there that everyone can follow to them. And bring that consistency, not just for people who are creating the content, and the same skew is that we have a lot of requests from teaching staff asking how to actually implement these adjustments, and through accessible digital accessibility, so adding extra time on for tests, etc. And so I think it's really important to have infrastructure of support and training for the teaching staff to enable them. us even in this space to keep up, never mind people who are not in the space, to really understand the complexities of that. And it's really important. But I think the absolutely crucial thing that universities can do to support teaching staff to ensure accessibility is time. And it's probably the one thing that they never get, just time to learn about and consider accessibility, a time to really work with specialized teams. As Danny was saying, learning designers can play a huge part in supporting teaching staff and how to really build that content and make sure that accessibility is intrinsic within that content. And also just having that opportunity and that time to be able to have individualized training and upskilling. Not all academics are made the same, and they're not all technically proficient. And so it's only fair that they have that support to train and to be able to get their heads around all of that. And I also think encouraging students to be more proactive, use accessibility as well, rather than just sitting back and expecting it all to happen, making sure that they understand what's available, how to use it, how they can implement that in their own learning as well, can make a huge difference to easing together to make this a much better learning experience.
Thanks, Tracy. We're having a few difficulties with the audio here, so I'm just going to try and summarise with those wonderful points.
Before you do, I think, Tracy, maybe when you talk next, maybe turning your video off might help the sound come through a little bit easier for us. So
that's a good point, Darlene. Thank you. But the points that were raised there by Tracy are making sure we get consistency and having the frameworks, the tools, the support for academics to allow that consistency, it's a great call. Providing time, it's, you know, let's be fair, I think that's one of the core aspects of this. And look, I think you're right, we're all created differently here. We've got challenges. So let's think about it in that context. And then the main point you also asked about the students is to empower them and encourage them to adopt as many of these tools as we can. I think there's some of the great points that you called out. So thank you, Tracy. I might then move on to Boyana.
Sorry, Danny, did you want to go? You had your hand up, I can go after you.
I'll go really quick. And then after you, this is kind of a throw to Darren as well, because one of the things that I most admire about Darren Britton I'm also a passionate advocate, is recognition and reward. You know, how do we expect people to do things that we are not placing value on within our institution? How do we award people? How do we recognize them? How do we celebrate what they are doing well? We can't always have a deficit mentality to accessibility, and that goes for our academic staff and all of our beautiful people working tirelessly, endlessly towards this. You know, on a journey, as you say, Taminda, it's not like we can say we're ever going to get there. We're just working away like little worker ants. And I think that there's a big space for celebration in there, and really, really acknowledging what people do very, very well right now. And they are. Leanna, to you. Sorry.
Thanks, Danny. So I think there appears to be quite a substantial misconception surrounding the importance of accessibility and it only being valuable to people with disabilities. And we know that this couldn't be further from the truth. So when it comes to larger organizations, and in particular universities, I think it's critical that the university at the first hand needs to recognize the importance of accessibility for every person and not just for people with disabilities. And that goes back to what Darren was saying earlier about that value. If we are not placing value on this, then we can't set expectations to staff. And if we don't set those expectations for staff, we can't move forward or provide them with additional time in order to do that. So I think it's really, really important for those of us who are in this space to keep advocating for this and pushing this forward for some change to happen.
Thank you. And I think Steve's got the hand up next, but then I think Danny invited Darren as well. Steve, first to you.
Darren can go first. He's the guy on this.
Yeah, no, that's all right. Go ahead, Steve.
I was just going to say, it was something that Ronnie mentioned right at the start, and it's an interesting point. The regression backwards is actually easier, and we seem to be putting things in front of things rather than removing them, which is something that I learned working with Darren for a long time, is that you review the model and you take things away, which is what I, when we first started working with Boyana, was go in and say, okay, how do we take stuff off the plate rather than adding stuff to it? And that was a necessity for that change to happen, to move your entire subject off onto a different platform, was to say, okay, how are we going to give you time rather than add more to it? And that to me was the key to sort of working around the process, because when you say to somebody, oh, we're going to give you more to do, they're immediately going to pull back and say, I'm already doing enough, or I'm already doing too much. So you've got to go in really, you know, and define what it is that they're doing and say, okay, so how do we strategically remove stuff from you so we can then add more in this direction? And that seems to be the things that missed quite often, instead of adding on or, you know, all these other things. Okay, how do we go in, takes off your plate? Yeah,
which goes, thanks, Steve. It goes straight to that time value question, you know, thing that's there. We can't ask you to do 110% if you don't have 110%, nobody does. You know, you take out all the factors of everything an academic has to do and then add this on. And then if we look at it from compliance point of view, then we're, you know, add that to the inbox with the 100 other things that I have to comply with and have done by Friday and have done by these times. But the value and reward part, I think is really key in terms of challenging and changing that conversation and starting to value it. But it also sits, I'm just noticing the chat pop up. It sits in a bigger discussion around where we want, I suppose, that accessibility to be. You know, I often hear, and I've heard this for many, many years, you know, and you'll hear from the different sides of, does it sit with teaching and learning accessibility, or does it sit with the student support side? No, it sits with everybody. There's room in the middle. But unfortunately, most institutions' funding has no money in the middle. There's funding for teaching and learning, and there's funding for student support. And both say it's your job. No, it's everybody's job. It's a collective job. So there needs to be centralized areas that help academics with this, that help with the support, and get some of this isn't easy to do either. That's the truth of this. And I often hear people say, well, the academic can just go make the transcript. And my first question is, have you ever done one yourself? One of your own things? Have you ever, it'll take you a couple of hours, you'll be frustrated as hell, and you'll start to be thinking, why am I doing this at the rate of pay I'm on, when maybe we can get some other people? You know, where's the value best spent and time best spent within institutions? And quite often the things that we think are simple or that we just want to push on to other people to do isn't helping. We have to value these. Some of these things are complicated. Some things are really easy. There's low-hanging fruit. There's things we can do in practice today that we can go and just start that happening. And the other side of to say with that is, we can't fix everything. We're not going to. And I think everybody's touched on that as well. This is a journey. It's so we can start to get something done. Everybody's different. This is my last point with this. And Steve's probably heard me say it to death, and maybe Danny has as well. You know, it took us probably, you know, a decade or more to start understanding every student is different. And we've started to value the student experience. It's part of key conversations at every institution. The student experience, every student's different. We need to rate them, et cetera, et cetera. But we need to start valuing that with staff as well. Every staff member is different. They come with their own set of experiences, skills, and attitudes and everything towards this. We can't just have one blanket. There's the training program. Go do that. And now we're covering this. It isn't a checkbox mentality. It's a cultural change that we need.
What a wonderful point you make. In fact, many organisations will often say your staff are your first customers. So I think that's a very important point for our sector as well. Really valid points by everyone. Thank you. This is the last question I have before we try and pick up a few from the audience. And this is about the future. So we've come a long way. I want to acknowledge all the amazing work everyone continues to do in this space. But it's, as we keep saying, it's not done. So considering that most organizations are thinking about diverse student cohorts, and as we said earlier, there's international, there's so many different variants now, and digital allows us to reach them, where is digital accessibility heading for our tertiary institutions? And again, open to the panel.
I'd like to start off with this one, if that's okay. So we recently developed a model at La Trobe, and this is to do with early career researchers, for example, where academics, level B or level A academic, is trying really, really hard to develop some sort of a plan to apply for grants, doesn't really know how to do it, very, very difficult. So what we're doing, we've developed this plan of where we match early career researchers with professors to assist in that process of grant writing. And so we're matching people from one, from the lower kind of end of this the academic spectrum to the higher. And so then these people can then share this information within their departments or outside their departments. So perhaps something like that could be organized here where, you know, I, for example, could be connected with someone from Deakin or with someone from Griffith, and I could learn from them. And then I could take that information to La Trobe, teach my discipline, teach my department, and spread that information in such a way. I think it would be organized like a mentor-menteeship. And I think I would find that very beneficial personally.
Fabulous call, Boyana. I think we should take that idea forward. Who else would like to comment?
I want to make a comment. It's a bit of a cheeky comment. It's not a direct answer to your question, because to be honest, I don't have an answer for you. I don't know where we're going next. But there's one thing that I do know, and I want to be very, very emphatic on this. I was very excited when Stephen mentioned regression, and Boyana touched on regression as well, regressing from all the progress that has been made during COVID. Do not allow for regression to happen. COVID has shown that we can provide multiple ways for people to access information. It has demonstrated that we can shift and move to online and provide hybrid ways of learning. And so do not allow for regression to happen. Do not allow for the old normal to come back. I still see some academics on social media and how they say, well, during the last 2 years, I was finally able to attend this conference because as a disabled academic, I felt safe. And now they are not offering online options anymore. They are going back to the old model of only in person. As we regress from the progress that has been made, people are being disabled again. People are being disadvantaged. So that's what I wanted to say. And that's why I got so excited when Stephen brought up the point of regression once again. I know it's not a direct answer to your question, but I think it is in relation to it, in the sense that to move forward, we need to stop moving backwards.
I think, Ronnie, that is absolutely the answer to the question, because I think what's next is that we don't allow or we don't accept going backward. That's the entire premise, I think, of the comment you're making, the point you're making, which is well said. Thank you.
I think, sorry, just to touch on that as well, Chaminda. And I think some institutions may be going backwards, but I think some are certainly embracing and taking that forward. I've forgotten which institutions, but there was two, and one in particular at our last assistive tech community practice, which Steve brought up earlier. One of the institutions is down, I think, to 90% less examinations than they did previous to COVID, and that's their new norm. There's other ways of assessing students, and I think, you know, some spaces like that is fantastic, because that's a rich discussion that's being had at the minute, not only around is it the best way to evaluate, you know, a student's learning, it's also because largely things have gone down that path, for whether you agree with me or not, because it was the path of least resistance and the easiest way to mass mark a whole bunch of students and do things. So, you know, looking at how we actually assess the learning that students are doing, you know, putting diversity into that learning, that not everybody has to go to a building, sit in a chair and be there, or in a proctored exam that does X, Y, and Z. You know, so shout out. I think we'll start to see some of these start to emerge, and the sector will start to look at what's happening at different institutions, TAFE as well, around how they're embracing, I think, those things that you're saying that have come out of COVID, and they've gone, actually, we were better off in some cases. So how do we continue that? How do we actually expand and build on that rather than go back to what it was? And it is scary to see some that are going back to, no, it's face-to-face only. We're only doing this. There's no blended learning where we're doing X. And for some courses, that might be fine. But yeah, I think I'm optimistic the future will be changing, so go with that there's some bits there. But also, technology is not going to solve all of our problems. We hear that AI is going to solve all of these things. It's not. Humans are still really good at interpreting those kind of things. AI isn't there just yet. And new technologies will come along. So we have to stop, evaluate the technologies before we use them. We jump in and use the latest tool or the latest bit of software in our online teaching without thinking about how accessible is this. So we've had students that have jumped in, whether that's with Mentimeter or, you know, any range of number of tools that have been used, again, where the options maybe have not been turned on, or there's been no thought or consideration for how other people are going to use this tool, let alone how we're expecting the academic to use these new tools to get the most out of them, and move away from that, you know, chalk and talk, or what's now, you know, PowerPoint and talk kind of thing, into, you know, true modes of dialogue and communication, as Steve said. So communication's the key, and the modes in which we do that. But I think there's also some technologies, you know, we're looking at augmented and virtual realities and things that are coming down the pipeline. And there'll be people which will be disabled just by that technology as well, that will get motion sickness, that will get things that haven't had a disability before. So how do we continue still training some students with VR where that may not be an appropriate form to do that in? And in some cases, as we said, going back to that reading pack mentality that we had many years ago, or the way that we delivered communication, would have been a perfect substitute for distance learning for a whole range of things that happened during COVID. We actually needed the distance learning model of what worked really well before, where we posted things out to students, we'd just be posting them electronically. So let's not forget the things we did in the past and say they're all old things that we did, and they were, you know, and we've moved on and we're now using better technology. Some of those simple things are some of the good things we need to embrace.
Thanks, Darren. And to be fair to the points that you just raised, both of you, going backwards at our own peril, because the younger generations, the core audience that we're about to bring on in the future, are digital natives already, but they've also got a very strong social compass, and they know, you know, their values are very strong. So if we start to go backward, our own future student, our customer, if you like, will choose to go elsewhere. So that's a really important point that you call out. In that context, Danny, can I come to you next?
The future is now. We're in it. It's happening. It happened very fast in COVID. And I think we're all now trying to come to terms with what that means. And I'm going to champion, let's not be innovative. Let's be consistent. Let's give our students that beautiful end-to-end experience. Let's take care of them and guide them gently, professionally, intelligently, looking at the modes and the media that we use in really intelligent ways, and understand when we communicate with them. And I think that all of my dear colleagues have been saying this all the way along. This is about one person communicating with another person, and that's tricky business even in the flesh. So you put media in between that, and there's so many ways it can go wrong. And I think let's be really careful when we adopt new technologies, like you say, Darren, and really think about what is the purpose and purposefully design. Future's right now. It's happening. We're in it.
We're in it. Thank you. Good call out. Tracy, maybe to you next. Maybe might be the camera off.
Yeah, totally agree with Danny, and we are where we are now, working through issues and how to really make that work effectively. So let's really put the effort into that rather than continue to have this sort of progress with technology and pushing on before we've actually, you know, worked out how to make this work really well for the people who are. And so that we can all really enhance the learning experience for students.
Thank you, Tracy. And maybe I'll we've got running out of time. This is a wonderful conversation, but I think we've got everyone's view. Stephen, I might throw to you as well.
I'd hearken to what Danny and Darren were saying about the tech. Someone is going to sound weird from someone who advocates for technology, but technology gives you the connection, but it removes the intimacy. And what we're trying to reintroduce is the intimacy into the process. So that's directly dealing with people and their needs and their experience and bring them back into the process. And that can mean regression back, you know, saying, okay, what do we need to take out that we put in the way of intimacy and the connection? And that to me, like going back to the original question, which is, you know, where are they headed? Where are we headed? Students aren't going to accept it. They're just not, they're doing it regardless if it's on your platform or somewhere else. So they're going to connect with each other and create community around the subjects and create community around the topics. They're going to do it whether you like it or not. So you might as well be involved in it. That to me is it's the non-negotiable anymore. It's there. We might as well be engaged with it and get out of their way, which is what a lot of this comes. This is what we're actually talking about is putting things in place so they can access us. You can get the hell out of the way, you know, get it, let them do their thing, you know, let them at it kind of thing. Yeah. Again, instilling back the intimacy into the process.
Thank you. And Darren, I saw your hand go up.
Yep. Just very, very quickly with that. The one thing I think we've lost in education, and this is with that, you know, just-in-time model aspect that's there, is I can recall, and I can even recall from when I was at university, there was flexibility in the curriculum. There's flexibility in assessment. There was flexibility. There was options. Unfortunately, most curriculum now seems fairly linear. Do A, go to B, go to C, then do D, etc., rather than you can do A, B, or C, and then you've got options to do this, you've got options to do this. And that's part of that time constraint that we're talking about in resources. So, you know, putting flexibility back in there, putting options, because education, you know, it's definitely, you know, we need to provide this option. Not everybody's the same. All our end users are different, and even two people with a screen reader will use things differently, etc., and have different experiences. So options, flexibility.
Fabulous. Thank you. Look, I think that's a wonderful place to maybe start acknowledging, you know, the conversation that we've had today. And to be fair, more than just today, I think it's important that we acknowledge the amazing work that everyone has done to get us to this point. You know, let's go back 4 or 5 years ago, and some of these conversations weren't even happening to this level. So my first call out is to everyone on this call, your colleagues who've done an amazing job to get us to this point. But as we all acknowledge, the job's not done. There's a lot to do, and we need to acknowledge the fact that there's going to be effort required. It's not going to just happen through... You know, it has happened throughout you know, drive of it, but it's got to be wider than that. And I think that's important. Huge call out to the panel. So let me just again thank Darren, Tracy, Ronnie, Danny, Stephen, and Bayana. What a wonderful conversation today. And to the entire audience, you know, you're here because you're clearly passionate about this, and you're also probably driving this agenda really hard in your own institution. So acknowledging your participation and thanking you for taking part, but also I think some of the call outs that have been made today about sharing, you know, looking at the community for support. I think Boyana talked about, you know, finding mentors and partners and, you know, support across the different institutions. I think we're better together is the key call out, and we're I think together able to, I think, influence much, you know, further than just our own institutions and our sector. So that's probably the big call out that we'll make. And to be fair, this topic should not be just discussed today. It is important that we acknowledge it on today's sort of date, but it should be discussed as often as we can and brought to life, and the needs acknowledged as many times as we can across the year. So huge thank you. And then of course, I want to just say a huge thank you to ADCET for all the work that you do, and also partnering with us today to have this and enable this conversation. I think that's probably where I'll hand it back to Darlene to bring us to a close.
Very good timekeeping there. Well done. I'm sorry we didn't get a chance to get to people's questions, but it was fantastic to see the conversation happening in the chat. So once again, thank you, Shaminda, for facilitating this session. You did a fabulous job, so Ben Joel, and also all the panelists, your knowledge and expertise and passion came through, and it was lovely to hear that and experience that. I also just want to take the opportunity to thank the Auslan interpreters and our captioners. Sitting back and listening to how fast people were talking, I commend you, so well done for that. I'm going to put into the chat just a plug for ADCET. We do have a regular newsletter that keeps everybody up to date with our webinars, our new content, et cetera. Yesterday we held a fabulous event, which I know many of you were at, which was a celebration of accessibility in action for ADCET, and it was a fairly emotional day of just seeing some of the great practice and being able to reward and acknowledge people. So that video will be up soon on ADCET, as this one will be as well, for people to enjoy and watch and continue their learning. All right, on that note, I will say good night and goodbye to everybody. Hope you have a great Thursday. Tomorrow's Friday. That's always a good thing. And take care.